decided to do our first album, When Broken is Easily Fixed, which we're pretty excited about. Some of these songs we haven't played in a while, so it's going to be really cool to play the record from start to finish. And I think it's going to bring back a lot of memories of the place in our lives where we were when we made the record. I mean, we had such an uncertain future. You know, we didn't know where we were going to be, if we were going to be, you know, doing music for 10 more years. I mean, I don't think any of us really thought we would. And it's just going to be really cool to play those songs.
This song is called Red Light Pledge.
Songs that we're playing tonight, we really haven't played since then, so it was really ambitious to break out the old catalog to actually rehearse it and try to get everything going again. But it's some of, you know, the songs that really formed our band and started us off in this as a career, so it's pretty cool to go back. I think there's a lot of nostalgia. I know there's a lot of early fans that have kind of come out of the woodwork for, especially for tonight, because they've never seen this album performed from start to finish, and some of these songs have never really been performed, so it's pretty exciting for us and for a lot of people coming tonight as well.
It's cool because we usually play, you know, at a normal concert, we'll play, you know, maybe one or two of these songs, at the most maybe three. And every time we play the old songs, it kind of gets me thinking back, you know, back to back in the day and where I was when I wrote the words or the music or whatever it was. And so it'll be cool to have a whole set of kind of feeling that way. I think that'll be something, a really special feeling. I think it's gonna, I'm gonna have a smile on my face the whole time, I think, tonight.
I think with that too, with the, especially with this first record, we, you know, we kind of see in ourselves how much we've grown as a band and as musicians and as people and like even as friends. And to see that, you know, to go back this far and to be like, oh, like, you know, this is how we used to do things, or like, this is like this, or like, I'm thinking like, you know, learning how to play these songs again, I was like, man, like, I really didn't know how to play bass when I joined this band. Like, so it's
super
it's
easy bass parts, yeah, on just, that record.
It's
yeah.
just really fun to see that, like with the whole weekend, just the progression of the band and how much we've been through and how much we've grown together. So I'm really excited just to relive it all over one weekend.
I live in the weak and the wounded. The end begins. As it pulls me.
Weird. I was kind of just starting to write songs for Silverstein at that point. Before that, I didn't really know how to write this kind of music, I think. I was more of a punk rock, like super fast music songwriter, and working with Josh, and then when Neil came into the band.
Last Days of Summer, I think I had that written before I even joined.
Exactly,
that,
yeah.
The first song,
exactly.
Yeah, that was originally, that wasn't really anything for any band. I just because.
It was an interesting song, Last Days of Summer, because I really think when you brought that to the table and we played it pretty much as it how it was, it really sort of shaped the next generation of our sound.
I brought a little more of an aggressive side to the music, and I guess it just evolved.
I remember that first practice when I walked in, and it was awkward once you're, you know, first band practice, and I really didn't know if you guys were feeling it at all. I was like, I laughed and I was like, I'm never gonna see those guys again. That's what I thought. And
when I first practiced with you guys, I thought Josh hated me. I'm so quiet.
I'll let you tell your perspective in a second, but I was sitting at work, I was doing the summer job, I was going to university, and it was summertime, and I was working at this like printing, like company that sells printers. So I was basically selling printers and fixing printers. Not that I know anything about them, but I was doing that job anyways. And I got a phone call from Paul at work. He's like, yeah, Tony from Victory just called me. And I was like, okay, who really called you? I was like, what? Are you serious? And like, couldn't believe it. And it was just such a crazy feeling to be like, wow, this isn't just in our little town here in Canada. This is like taking the band elsewhere, and somebody really cares outside of our little area. And then what happened from there? We ended up, he wanted to fly up and see us, and I think it was like 2 days later he came up and we had breakfast with Tony, who owns Victory, and pretty much, I mean, he didn't sign us on the spot, but he let it be known he was really interested. And I think it was just a month after that we were on Victory Records. So it all happened so fast.
It was funny for me, I was 17 in 2002, and we had decided to do the demos and start sending out some packages to labels, and then we did a tour, and I was still in high school, and like you guys had like a spring break or something from college and could go on tour, and I had to take 2 weeks off of high school, and like I said to my parents, I was like, I need to take time off school to go on tour, and they were like, well, no, there's no way you're doing that, and I like literally started crying and just like was in tears because I was so passionate about it, and this was like my dream. I wanted to go on tour, they just, that we talked, I talked about it some more, and they understood, and they let me go, and then they were kind of like, oh, but like, don't think too much of this band thing, like, you really got to get back from tour, and you got to like, pull up your grades and stuff. And then I remember that, you know, I finished that year off, and went to summer, and then that summer, we got signed to Victory, and I was just like, see, I did it, like, I got a record deal, you know what I mean, like, we're, you know, I'm gonna be in a band. And then I finished high school that, like, I only had one semester left, so I finished in like finished high school at Christmas, and then January 1st we started recording When Broken Is Easily Fixed, and spent that whole time in the studio, and then right into the spring started touring, and like it seems like we've been on the road for the past 7 years nonstop, but it's like it couldn't have been a better time for me finishing high school and taking the next step of my life with the band.
Stop myself before I reach this town. I was Hey, so we're here at the Alma Combo. We're gonna play Discovering the Waterfront tonight for the second night of our 4-night anniversary shows. Really excited about this record. I think that this record had the most success out of any of our records and was a big milestone for our band.
Yeah, it definitely was the turning point. I think this record is kind of when we went from, oh, we're just like a new band, to a really serious band in people's minds. You know, this is when people really started getting lyrics and stuff tattooed all over their bodies. And so I think this is the record that we expected the biggest turnout for, and the show's already been sold out for a while, so it's gonna be really cool tonight. I think it's gonna be the biggest, craziest night.
I will promise myself I won't care, distracting myself from your stare. And I've seen this mistake once before. With your games I will never fall for. I've held up my guns, I won't kill. Fighting!
The era of Discovering the Waterfront was kind of when we took the band to a more professional level, where, you know, we made a record outside of our hometown. We spent a lot of time writing and recording it, you know, and then, and you know, made some bigger music videos and really put more time into promotion and marketing and really setting up the record in a more professional way, like I guess like full-time bands would do.
When we made the record, I guess before we went into the studio, we had put out When Broken Is Easily Fixed, and it had done better than anybody thought. Like, we had no expectations at that time. We were a brand new band in everybody's eyes, never had a record out in stores, and people liked it. And when it kind of came time to do a new record, went down to California and met with Cameron, and just had a great time.
Yeah, I remember we didn't know who was going to produce the record, and we were talking to David Bendith, who's done some really big records now, about doing our record, and it just, everything kind of fell apart. And at the last minute,
we were in Europe,
and we were trying to sort it out.
Darren from the Hurt Process helped us out with that.
Exactly.
Oh, we got this great guy that we worked with, really nice guy, easy to get along with, and really good producers. It's great sounding
record. And we had this record by this band called Park.
Oh yeah,
Little band, and we like listen to the record every day. And then we were like, wait a minute, isn't that the guy that did the Park record? And like no one had heard of Park. And we're like, oh, we love the sound of that record. Like, I bet he could do a really good job for us. And I think we really made a great choice in Cameron, and found a guy that's, you know, not like a great friendship and just a really good asset to our band, and almost like a sixth member.
Absolutely.
Blame it on the world, but I'm a mess. look back with honor and no regrets. I won't be back. These men, they're believing. Don't be sad, 'cause life goes on. It's getting too late. Tomorrow is here. Thank you, Toronto!
When we made When Broken is Easily Fixed, and I talked about it yesterday, that, you know, we didn't know what our future was going to be at all. Whether we were going to be a professional band with a career, or if we were just going to do this, go on a couple tours, and that would be it. And I think with Discovering the Waterfront, it was really the make or break for us. And with, like, personally, I think at that time, you know, my girlfriend at the time was like, is this like, what are you doing? Are you making another record? Are you going to be on tour for another 2 years? Or like, are we going to settle down, or what are you going to do? And a lot of this, the record's about that, actually, and about, you know, kind of whether I'm going to, I mean, there's a line like, I'd rather burn 16 stories, I'd rather burn than fall. And it's like, it's kind of about that. It's what do you want to do? Do you want to like sit around and live your life like that, or do you want to be out on the road and live your life like that? And that's kind of the choices that we had to make at that time.
Yeah, that's definitely the concept of Discovering the Waterfront. I remember having a conversation about it. It was something that like Paul came up with even years before, and then we kind of talked about the title and like what that meant to us. And with this record, we were, yeah, like Shane said, we had a choice in our lives whether we were gonna stay at home and do things as normal people our age were growing up, and you know, taking the safe road and staying on the shore, or if we're gonna go up and, you know, venture new waters and go into the unknown and you know, do this with our life as a band and in our career. So
exactly.
that was the main point in our lives, I think.
I mean, even the album cover itself, the drawing, that's sort of what we wanted it to depict. You have like the guy on the shore and the burning city behind him, and then the water kind of going off into the unknown. And that was really just an analogy for what we were, you know, going through at that time in our lives.
During the time between When Broken is Easily Fixed and Discovering the Waterfront, we were performing about over 200 shows a year, and that doesn't even include travel days and rehearsal days and writing and all that stuff. So we were really, really focused on what was going on, like just being out there promoting our band. So I don't think we had a really big picture of what we were becoming from all this. So it was kind of cool that we were just kind of lost in the moment and lost in the road and lost in playing music. And then like years later, we kind of look back and like, it's crazy to see like how well things were going and how it was taking off. We didn't even realize it because
we were working so hard.
Yeah, you're working so hard. You're just concerned about like driving to the next city, about making it for time for load-in, making sure, you know, the records.
I remember around that time when we were working on those songs and we were doing a tour or something, and none of us had cell phones or computers or anything yet, really, so we were so disconnected. And I remember looking at our MySpace page at some kid's house and like making an update and being like, man, like, this is getting like crazy now, like all this internet stuff and all these, like, you add a friend. I don't even think it was MySpace, I think it was Friendster at that point. And it's just crazy how we almost thought maybe we should just stay home so we could like do some internet stuff, because we didn't even have computers or phones or anything. We just drove and slept at kids' houses and played shows and partied.
Well, yeah,
it was fun.
Back in the day, we thought that, you know, playing shows is the only way to reach fans. You know, we didn't realize that you could tap into them so instantly with the, you know, the internet and communication stuff like that.
All right, I'll
shit crazy, okay? One more time! We are Silverstein! And this song is called...
has made an impact on their life for some reason. Why do you guys think it's so much more important?
Absolutely. I think this, I mean, this is the biggest record we've done. I mean, this is the record kids really latched onto. I think it's sold over 500,000 copies worldwide or something like that. I mean, it's a big record, and we've never, there's a lot of these songs we've never played live before. I'm sure a lot of the kids are really looking forward to seeing some of them, and especially hearing the whole record from start to finish. So it's going to be special for people, and I've seen people get, you know, words from Call It Karma and from other songs on this record tattooed on them, and I think that the reason people are here from all over the world this weekend is to hear some of these songs performed live and, you know, kind of feel like they did in their bedroom listening to the record, but be able to see it and see the band really play it is gonna be special.
I think when Broken Is Easily Fixed was, you know, our debut record and the start, and there was a lot of kids last night that were really excited, for like local fans and friends of ours, because that was like our grassroots start. But I think with Discovering the Waterfront, it was really where the majority of the world found out about Silverstein and, you know, knew that we were a real band and what we were doing, and became most kids became familiar with Discovering the Waterfront in their early stages, rather than when Broken Is Easily Fixed. So I think that a lot of the nostalgia for the kids is for this record.
What the record really meant for me was just the great experience of it all, just the process of the songwriting, which was quite the process, actually. We did a lot of demoing and a lot of pre-production for it. And the fact that we were living in California while we were recording it was a great experience, because I've never done that personally in my life. So living in California for a month was really fun and exciting. And it was very a relaxed environment, and I think that really helped with the life in the studio, getting things done.
I remember that record, Discovering the Waterfront, it was painful at times, because we had a lot of arguments amongst, you know, each other and how we wanted the songs to be. I think everyone, the really cool thing was we'd spent so much time together touring the When Broken record cycle that I think we'd really start to grow as friends and grow as understanding each other and what we like musically and everything. And I think we really started to click with Discovering. And at the same time, we butted heads, I think, because we just all felt so passionate about the direction we were going.
Everyone wanted the best for each song, I think.
Absolutely, we did. And it was really cool. Like, there were times when we'd just get so excited about a part of a song that everyone would want to, like, everyone had this vision of where the song should go.
Yeah.
And that made I think that made the record really strong, but it also made it difficult to put it all together.
Self. Are you still somebody else? There's so much bottled up inside. Now it's been shaken up. It's going to explode. And you can't stop it. You just can't stop it. You say you're done. You swear you gave it up. Running in circles, you don't. Thorn still in your side, and will you pull it out in time? But now it starts to overflow, spill its guts and ruin someone's soul. And you can't stop it, you just can't stop it. You say you're done. You swear. You're running.
monsters of control.
Thank you very much.
So tonight we're back at the Elma Combo in Toronto playing Arrivals and Departures from start to finish. This record was an interesting time in our lives. We had basically toured our butts off, I think, quite literally, for the better part of, I guess, 2 years, was it? Supporting Discovering the Waterfront. And we went all over the world. Some incredible places, played some incredible shows, and really kind of got settled into being a professional band. And now it's our chance to make our next record, the one after Discovering the Waterfront, which was kind of our breakthrough. It was an intimidating task.
I think for the first time in our career, we were really in a position where we could do anything we wanted to do. We could work with any producer we wanted to do, we could record in any studio we wanted. And we had a lot of freedom, which was really cool. We spent a lot of time writing, actually, and we wrote more songs than we'd ever written on previous albums. We ended up with, I think we had 15 or 16 songs done, and we were gonna narrow it down to 11. And we went out to California again, but this time we were writing in Hollywood in LA, and we recorded with Mark Trombino. And it was a much different vibe in LA and with Mark than I think we'd ever experienced before recording. And I think that it kind of shows on that record. I think we kind of maybe bit off a bit more than we could chew. I think we maybe took things a little bit too, I don't know the word.
I think we were really just consumed with the band and we didn't really, I mean, we did take a lot of time to write the songs, but we didn't have any time away. Like, you know, we were doing the band for so many years, straight from When Broken Is Easily Fixed into Discovering the Waterfront, and then really hard, and like the success of the band was just going up, and like I think all of our personal lives were like in disarray. Like,
just need time to reflect.
Yeah, maybe. And we were really like consumed by the band, and we were thinking like, oh, what do we need to do to like make the next step as a band, and what can make this album the best, and like, yeah, like you said, we all had all this freedom, but at the same time, I don't think we really took enough time to like really think what was going on, and yeah, we had like our friend John Beats from Bayside pass away on the road with a tragic accident with that, and then we came home and we lost a really close friend of ours, Nick Hurlbutt, and I know that a bunch of the guys had relationships ending, and we all had like just a lot on our plates, and I think that no one really took the time to like stop and like take a step back out of the, you know, out of the box of where we were as the band at the time.
Mm-hmm. And really say, okay, like, let's get our shit together. We're okay.
Yeah.
Now let's, you know, let's further what we need to do and let's go make a record. And I mean, that record was a really hard time for me. I had just broken up with my girlfriend of 7 years. So to go out there and just try to focus was hard, and there's a lot of distractions in the big city of Los Angeles, where Discovering the Waterfront, we did it out in Orange County, where there was still a lot going on, but it wasn't like these crazy LA parties every night that we're getting, people were calling up and being like, come out.
I think because when we did Discovering the Waterfront, we were still young and a new band, and we hadn't toured that much. We'd only been to California like two or three times, but by the time we went to do Arrivals, it was like, we knew everyone, and every night there was like either a show or a party or a movie or just something. Like, we were all pretty distracted.
Yeah, and I mean, there's a lot of things going on in our lives, but the recording process itself, working with Mark, you know, we've been pretty public on how it was a tough time for us and how we weren't totally happy with the record. But I really think that was just what we went for production-wise. We went for a really stripped-down record. A more rock sounding record, a less slick record. which I think was a cool approach to take, especially with those songs. Mm-hmm. But I just think it didn't really translate the best way it could production-wise. And we really ran out of time, too, with this record. We didn't we didn't spend enough time really, or I mean, we didn't book enough time to get everything out. And like, the record's only 11 songs, but we actually did three more songs, so it was 14, and then we actually had a 15th song that we didn't end up finishing. So it was a lot of songs to work out, and I think I ended up doing all the screaming for Arrivals in one day.
Really?
I think it was all in one day, or maybe a day and a half. So that was a like very stressful time for me, and I think it was maybe the most, finishing the vocals on that were maybe the most depressing days of my entire life. I'm not even kidding.
I remember when all of us were like going home for a bit and you stayed behind to do vocals and we're all getting in the car, you look so bummed.
Dude, yeah, like you guys play. I was there alone in this Oakwoods apartment, like depressing, just the most depressing thing ever. Like by myself, like
living in the closet.
My voice just totally shredded and just having like no one to talk to, and it was a really, really hard time. I mean, the weird thing was I got home and I felt good about that record, and I still think some of the songs on that record are some of our best, some of our strongest. And a lot of people say that that's their favorite record. And I mean, you can definitely, I mean, it's a hard record for me to listen to and think about the lyrics and stuff, because I feel my own pain.
It really brings me back to that personal stuff.
Myself as well, yeah. Shane talked about he broke up with his girlfriend of 7 years. While we were recording it, I actually broke up with my girlfriend of 6 years. And listening to that record is hard. Like, a lot of what you sing about from your experience, I can relate to, because we dated those girls for almost the same amount of time, and were friends, and hung out a lot. So I think any experiences you wrote about were often shared experiences for us.
I think for sure, because we were all doing the same thing. We were on tour together, we were in the same shoes, and like, something, not only was like something that happened to Shane affecting us because we were so close to him, but we were having the same sort of things happen to us as well. So that was I think I remember specifically something that was kind of funny was that your ex-girlfriend had moved out to LA at the time we were recording the record, and you were like, oh, I'm gonna go hang out with her. And I'm like, dude, I don't know if that's such a good idea. And then the next day you came home and you're like, hey man, I wrote these lyrics last night, like I want you to check them out. And it was for Vanity and Greed, and I remember looking over the lyrics and being like, dude, I think these are my favorite lyrics you've ever written. Like, maybe that was a good idea.
Like, put as much strife in my life as possible. Let's see what happens.
I mean, I think Arrivals and Departures was really like the growing pains era of the band. Especially where like discovering the waterfront just kind of happened and it was embraced and everything kind of clicked. But you know, we were just doing what we thought was cool, and we didn't really have many expectations even back then, and we were so just busy, it just kind of flowed, and now we were put more in the spotlight to make a really good record, to work with a big time producer and have all this stuff click, and it just didn't, because we were like so much more self-aware for the first time ever as a band and as individuals.
Song is called Still Dreaming.
Feelings are falling downward. I want to forget. Waking up, I hear the way your voice sounds. My heart starts to pound now, into the rhythm of yours. You're so angelic, your words so symphonic. Touch your lips to my soul, eat this sorrow. How am I so lucky I found you? Sometimes I feel like I'm still dreaming. It seems like every day you're always on my mind. This is how we stay so connected over space and time. When we talk about all Neil's old drama, we look at me and wonder how I'm not insane. the days seem to get longer, but you know our love gets stronger with every word we say, stronger every day. You know I would do anything for you. Sometimes I feel like I'm still dreaming. It seems like every day you're always on my mind. This is how we stay so connected, so connected over space and time. If you were feeling down, you know I'd feel it now. We give each other strength to make it through the darkness. You take me to a place I never want to leave. I'm in my deepest dream, I don't ever want to wake up. I'll fight till I die, I won't say goodbye.
It's been 10 years, I guess, that he has been doing this with Silverstein, and a couple of years before then, as a very young teenager, he got involved in a couple of other bands. And over the years, I guess we've seen him mature, to see him grow, to see him develop as a musician and as a writer. And we've done our best to support him. Although in some cases it was a difficult transition when he first got involved, because he was in third year university and decided to do this full time. And to do this full time meant dropping out of third year university, which on one hand was a bit of a negative, because he was supposed to getting his a bachelor's degree. But on the other hand, I guess one has to pursue one's dream, and he did so at the time. And here we are many years later. He's at a level of success that I guess a lot of people would aspire to be at.
Yes, when Shane was, when he first started to play guitar, he was quite young, maybe 11 years old, maybe earlier. And from the time he picked up a guitar and started to use it and to sing, he practically could never put it down. So I knew that when he had an opportunity to play music and to be in the band, that that was something he should do. And I was very happy about it.
So since we decided to quit school and quit our jobs and become musicians, we've done a lot of touring all over the world. And when you're away from home, you miss your family and you miss your friends. But you make a lot of friends and a lot of new family on the road. And in 2005, we were out with some of our best friends on the Victory Records tour. Hi, Tony. With Hawthorne Heights and Bayside and Aiden. It was a great fucking tour. Until about the third day, when Bayside hit some black ice and flipped over, and their drummer, John Beats, died. And that was the worst day of our lives, and we wrote this song about it. It's called Here Today, Gone Tomorrow.
With you.
Saying our goodbyes, drive away from the past.
Silverstein has meant a lot to us because of our own relationship and how the music has connected us. He was in the military and gone for long periods of time, and he introduced me to Silverstein. So him always listening to the songs really made me get into it. And when he was gone, listening to Silverstein's songs was a way for us to stay connected even though we couldn't be together. And it meant a lot to us.
My heroine is it's actually helped me out quite a few times through some really tough moments. Call It Karma is just, it's my anthem. That is what I base myself on. Like, I love that song. I can't go a day without listening to it. It's just impossible.
We have a very good friend. Hang on. We have a very good friend. He works for us. He's worked for us since 2002. Two, whatever. We'll say 2002, it sounds longer. His name's Kevin, he puts up with all our bullshit. He does all our stage stuff. And this is the song he likes the most, so we're gonna play it for him because we fucked it up yesterday. It's called Already Dead.
Find me here, the place that you expected me to be. In my bed on the second floor, I'm outside your house, I'm closing in on you. In all the times you left, you said hello and thought I was okay. I was
Kyle Bishop. I used to sing for a band called Grade quite some time ago amongst a bunch of other crappy bands. I know Silverstein through weird circumstances, I guess. At the time, sometimes in 2000, I believe it was, maybe even 99, Charles, who was drumming for us at the time, Charles Monez, introduced me to the guys from Silverstein, which I guess I already knew from shows when they would come to shows at the local scene. Little Fat Bill shaking his ass in the front of the stage. Such a little nerd, but he was funny as hell. And I always enjoyed the fact that he just kept going and didn't give a shit what anyone else thought. And we were playing a show for, I think, one of the first shows for our album Separate the Magnets. And Charles asked if this band Silverstein could open up. And I was like, sure, no problems. And it ended up being Bill and Shane and everybody else that you saw at the shows over the years. And I watched them and they were horrible. And I don't mean to say that in a bad way. They were just bad and I was a jaded old prick that didn't give a fuck about nothing. And that was it. And then later on, I was at the Victory offices in Chicago and there was something playing. It was I believe it was a demo of some sort that Charles brought in. And I thought, oh, this is pretty interesting, whatever it was, if I'm even thinking correctly right now. And Tony asked me, what do you think about this band? I was like, this sounds great. And he's like, they're from your city. And I was like, this is the same band? And I was very surprised about that and never really thought much about them after that until we came off tour one time and Coop, who did our Under the Radar record amongst a bunch of other stuff, he asked me to come sing on the Silverstein debut record.
We were just a local band from around here, from Burlington. No one would give us a chance. We made demos, we sent them out. And Victory fucking cared. Victory noticed. And within 48 hours of hearing our demo, Tony flew up to Toronto to meet with us. And that's fucking cool. We appreciate that, Tony. Thank you for everything. This is for you. The song is called Smile in Your Sleep.
Play the motions through my head. You know that I'm thinking. Come on. And I have reasons to believe that I'm not the only one you spend this time with. When you're lying in your bed,
Your eulogy's been read, you know that it's fitting.
For me personally, Smile in Your Sleep, and like I said before, it really grips me. The emotion's just charged in that song, and I love how it goes from just this nice, you know, nice, beautiful falsetto, and it just crushes you with that scream.
So we're standing on stage at the Alma Combo right now. We're about to perform Shipwreck in the Sand from start to finish. It's our fourth night. It's been awesome so far. Three crazy shows. And tonight I think will be no exception. I think this night is definitely the night where the album is most complete from start to finish. Shipwreck in the Sand, as a lot of you guys know, is a concept record where pretty much flows from front to back, and we're going to try to do that live tonight. And we've got, you know, a lot more things, tricks up our sleeves, I guess, to kind of pull that off tonight. So it's going to be the most challenging show of the four, I think, tonight, but it'll also be, I think, the most rewarding and the coolest one.
I think it's exciting too, since it's the album that's freshest with us, you know, only having recorded it last year and been playing a lot of these songs on our last few tours since they're new and exciting to us. So it's cool to be doing it and finally playing this album from start to finish, kind of how we intended the album to be heard, is one unit where it's not just a collection of songs or whatever. So it's actually nice to be able to play it from start to finish, which we've never been able to do before this.
It's called American Dream.
Never thought I'd make such a big mistake, throw my life away. I've gone days without food, I've went weeks without sleep, keeping this. I've got cuts I can't close, I've got wounds that won't heal. It's all yours. Scars on my skin. I forgot how to feel. Now I'm weak with deceit. My skin is paper thin. We get through this. Feeling it, keeping it, holding it in. We go through this over and over again. I go years without tears in a life with no fear. Life without you. Now I'm breaking my back as I cover my tracks. My skin is paper thin. Watch again. We get through this. Feeling it, keeping it, holding it in. We go through this over and over again. I've gone days without food. I've went weak without sleep, keep the best in. I've got cuts I can't close, I've got wounds that won't heal. It's all your fault. My American dream wasn't ever to like the USA. He won't leave. Perform this. What's the point?
The first time I met Silverstein, I was putting on shows in Charlottetown, PEI, and they had come through, and I think it was probably one of the biggest shows I had done to date at that point. They were on Feldman, and there was a rider, and I think I probably screwed up the rider, and some of the guys in Somehow Hollow were pretty pissed off at me about that. But the Silverstein guys were totally cool, and that was just when Broken Easily Fixed came out, and they were across Canada on that record, and it was amazing because being in Charlottetown, we didn't get a lot of tours coming through, and it was really cool. It was at a time in the scene out there was really starting to explode, and I think that Silverstein show was probably one of the biggest shows we did at the time. And they came out, and we pretty much sold out this old fire hall, and they played the show. And I remember that night We went and played a beach party, or we didn't play a beach party, we went to a beach party, and Billy from Silverstein brought his acoustic guitars out onto the beach, and he kept playing this Get Up Kids song. I think it was Out of Reach, I guess. And classic campfire song. And I remember, I was like, man, this guy's got to be like the coolest dude ever. Like, he loves Get Up Kids as much as me. And then we sat in the van, like driving back to the city, and they were telling us about all these cool tour experiences that they had. And I was really excited that our friendship kind of continued from then on, and they've gone on to do some really amazing things with the band. And that was probably one of the earliest memories I have of them.
The concept of the record, Shipwreck in the Sand, it is complicated, and there's a lot of stuff going on, and I like that about it. I like that it isn't obvious. I like that a lot of people can take something out of it that's their own, and that's always something that we try to do with all of our records, is make something that someone can relate to. And each song, you know, tells a story of its own as well. So it was really important not only to have a concept record of, you know, 14 tracks, but also have each song have kind of, you know, a story within the story. But there's a lot of things I wanted to talk about. I mean, the reason I wanted to do a concept record was because just the way the world is right now, with the economy being so messed up and people losing jobs and families losing their life savings and not knowing what they're going to do in the future. And, you know, 10 years ago, it's just everything was going so well, and you know, people weren't as concerned, and now it's a really, really scary time. I've seen it happen even with my own family, so that's what I wanted to focus on mainly. So a lot of it is looking into what the problems are with that, government. There's a lot of political issues, underlying issues within the record about what the government is spending money on, both, you know, not just the American government, but the Canadian government and governments all over the world, and what their focus is on. There's a lot of social
issues I wanted to talk about as well. I mean, people, you know, that watch reality TV and think that cribs is the way their house needs to look, or they need to look like people when they flip through their Cosmopolitan magazines or, you know, whatever else. And there's just so many problems that face society right now, and I just really wanted to tackle them all. And each song kind of just dives into a different issue, and, you know, the issue of healthcare right now in the U.S. and how uncertain that is, and how it's just so divided when it just should be so obvious. There's just a lot of things I really wanted to talk about in the concept.
Every album that came out, I got more and more tattoos. I think I got like 19 or 20 now. I lost count, but I'm gonna still get more tattoos as stuff comes out. And you know, I've made friends with all of them. They don't treat me like a fan, they treat me like a friend. Just have so many memories. I went to LA to watch them record Arrivals and Departures. They came down to San Diego during that recording session. And we spent the whole day one time. We went to see a Padres game in the morning, and then the Tarantino film in the afternoon, and then that night we went to see our favorite band, Mew, at this place in Solana Beach. And it was just like, you know, like we had known each other our whole lives, and we'd only known each other for like 3 years.
Whoever would like to start.
I think when we were first nominated for a Juno Award for our record Discovering the Waterfront was a real eye-opener. Like, I don't think any of us could have thought about such a thing happening for this band. And I was personally surprised. And when we first found out, I was ecstatic. We were all ecstatic.
Yeah, it was crazy, because coming from such a punk rock DIY scene, you know, in Burlington, I mean, I never knew any bands or had any friends that got nominated for Junos or anything, and I never thought we would, you know? But then suddenly, out of nowhere, the mainstream is kind of embracing our bands and inviting us out to something like that, and it was cool. I mean, it was really some next level shit for us, so it was cool.
I think one of the great elements about our band is that we really look at the world as a potential fan base and as a place to conquer, where some bands, you know, stick to their home territory, whether it's Canada or the US, and just really focus on that. But for our band, we've always just wanted to take our music and ourselves to new and exciting places. And over the 10 years as a band, we've been fortunate enough to perform in 26 different countries for over 1,200 shows in total as of right now, which is pretty amazing to think of cramming that all into, you know, the years that we've been actively touring, which is really only about 7 of the 10 where we started really globe trotting. But it's just awesome, you know, to see all the different things that we've been able to do as a band. And, you know, it's like a vacation with benefits of playing music and seeing the world. It's really, really, really lucky.
I think I've definitely enjoyed the travel element of touring, especially abroad. It's just really cool to be able to go to all these countries, 26 countries, but especially to go back and to kind of have a map in your brain of like where you've been and like what's good and where's cool to hang out and where to eat food and where to shop. And to almost like, I know there's been scenarios where we've gotten like lost, and it's like just really cool to be able to say like, oh, like I got lost in Scotland and found my way back to like the bus, or I, you know, got lost in Japan and slept on the street and
got lost in Paris,
found my way back to the hotel. Yeah, it's, I mean, I've gotten lost in a lot of cities and been able to find my way back. And it's just great to have my own kind of urban compass of every major city in the world. It's a big accomplishment for me. I'm really proud of that.
Sorry, I am.
It's cool.
I'd have to say another great thing that we have built up over the last 10 years of traveling the world is great friendships. In all these different places that we go, we meet people, and every time we come back, it's nice to see their faces again and just hear how their lives have been while we've been gone, and tell them stories of what we've been up to, and just share that and have these lasting friendships that, like, I'm hoping when I go and visit these places when I'm an old man, I can still see these people and say hi and share stories. It's a fantastic thing.
Here ritually to do. It's called My Heroine.
The drugs began to peak. A smile of joy arrives in me, but sedation changes to panic and nausea, and breath starts to shorten, and heartbeats sound softer. You won't try to save me. Want to hurt me and leave me desperate. You taught my heart a sense I never knew I had. I can't forget the times that I was lost and depressed from the awful truth. I knew you'd do it. You're my sense I never knew I had. I can't forget the times that I was lost and depressed from the awful truth. Do you do it? You're my hero. I bet you laugh at the thought of me thinking for myself. That I'm better with you than someone else. Your face arrives again. I hope I had become surreal, but under your covers, more torture than pleasure. Just past your lips, there's more anger than laughter. Not now or forever will I ever change you. I know that to go on, I'll break you, my heaven.
You taught my heart a sense I never knew I had. I can't forget the times that I was lost and depressed from the awful truth. I didn't do it. You're my hero.
You taught my heart a sense I never knew I had.
Once upon a time, before the lakes and rivers were polluted, before the animals were poached to extinction, and before man had destroyed the Earth's atmosphere, there was a great ship. This vessel was to venture into new waters, to find new resources, to make life easier and more enjoyable. It was a simple mission for the crew, who were excited to be a part of this union. They pledged their allegiance to the captain, and vowed to be there no matter what, in sickness, health, and possible death. As time passed by, there was no new land to be found. As the days grew shorter and the nights grew longer and colder, the crew became more and more skeptical about the captain's vision. Originally passionate and committed, true and faithful,